think of as our finite field or the algebraic closure of this finite field. And I have a linear system, that means a projective linear subspace of the space of effective divisors, linearly equivalent to our given divisor, delta given divisor, of course defined over our field, and the degree of delta is equal to d. And let's say that the dimension of L, which is the dimension as a projective space, is equal to n. That is the situation that we consider, and we also assume that this L is base point free, and then L gives rise, so base point free, meaning that there is no point contained in all divisors in this linear system, not in the support of all these divisors, and then we have a map from C to projective space, Pn, where n is the n of the space L, and we can assume that it is given by functions f0 to fn, where these functions are functions in the function field of our curve. Okay, that is the situation. And then if I have a point on the curve P, we associated a set JLP of integers J0 up to Jn, which are the different orders that the divisors in our linear system L can have at this point P. So the orders of the different orders that occur. And what we also did is that we looked at the general case, not at a specific point, at a special point, but we looked at the generic point, and then we defined numbers epsilon 0 to epsilon n. And we did this by looking at a local parameter t, at a separating variable t, and then we looked at determinant, where we apply these Hasse derivatives. Well, let me say Fj. We looked at the smallest epsilon successively chosen, such that this determinant is not identically zero. And then we have seen that this Wronskian, as it is called, this determinant n plus 1 by n plus 1 determinant, that this determinant defines an element of L k, sum epsilon I times k plus n times delta, where k is, say, the divisor of dt, the differential form dt. And hence, we see that we get an effective divisor r greater than or equal to zero, which is linearly equivalent, r is linearly equivalent to the sum epsilon I times k plus n times, n plus one times delta. And so this R is an effective divisor that we find on our curve. Well, it depends, of course, on a choice. Namely, it depends on the choice of this linear system L. But I could, for example, take a special case where L is also canonically given. Namely, if I take for L the canonical, for delta the canonical divisor, and for L the complete linear system that corresponds to it, I would find a divisor provided that this base point free, but if the genus is greater than or equal to 2, say, it's a base point free, and I would find an explicit divisor, effective, which is God-given on our curve. So it's something canonical then. But in our case, well, we choose our L, and we still find this explicit, effective divisor. And last time we proved a lemma. Let me repeat it. The lemma says, well, in this situation, if I have this JLP is the set of numbers J0 to JN, then I have that the order at P of R is greater than or equal than the sum of these ji minus epsilon I, and we can even say that we have equality with equality if and only if some determinant was not zero modulo p. The determinant, p is the characteristic in our case, j a epsilon b, where this a and b, if this determinant is not zero modulo p. Okay, so if you assume that this determinant is not zero modulo p for one reason or another, then you see that we find this divisor R, namely, this is just, it gets contributions in the cases where the ji are not equal to the epsilon I. If the ji, we know that that is what we saw also last time, that the ji are greater than or equal to the epsilon I. And you see, you get contributions from the cases where the ji are greater than the some ji are greater than the epsilon I, and these are the so-called Weierstrass points for this linear system L. So these are very special points where something happens. But this is what we find, and we found it by just writing down these functions and developing these functions, fb, and they start, let them start with t to the power jb, and then we did a little calculation and we saw this thing. Well, we are going to prove a number of lemmata because we want to estimate sort of the multiplicities of R at points B, or to see when this condition is fulfilled. And one of these instances is the following: if the product of JA minus JB divided by A minus B, if this product where A, say, is greater than B, is greater than or equal to 0, less than or equal to n, if this is not 0 modulo p, then, well, in that case, we have that L is classical, meaning that the ji are equal to the epsilon I, all I. And we also have that the order at P of R is equal to some ji minus epsilon, minus I, epsilon I. Yeah. I mean, of course, here I mean classical, sorry. Epsilon I is equal to I. Right. So this, of course, is then equal to I. Sorry. That is the statement. So let us try to prove this now. How do we do this? Well, we write down a determinant, the determinant of the D, and now I take just A of FB. Well, this we calculate in a way as we did it last time. So what is this? This is the same as the determinant. And then, well, if I do this Husser derivative, so the FB starts with, say, T to the power JB. So I get a binomial coefficient, JB choose A, times T to the power JB minus A, but I will take this out, and then I have this determinant of A with A and B running, and then I get here T to the sum J B minus A. JB minus B. Okay, plus lower order terms. So we have to look at this, but so let's look at that. What do we get there? Well, I have to calculate this determinant, but so J, the determinant of J B A, where A and B are running. Well, how does this start? I claim this is the same as the determinant of J B to the power A divided by A factorial. Right, divided by 1 factorial, 2 factorial, up to n factorial. Because what do we get? So look at a simple example. What you would get is something like, for n is 2, you would get 1, 1, 1, j0, j1, j2. And then you would have j0 choose 2, etc. But this J0 choose 2 is J0 times J0, is J0 squared minus J0 divided by 2. So I can take the 2 out. And then you have the J0 squared. But this J0, well, this gives something that is linearly dependent on this. So I can forget it when I calculate a determinant. And you see that you get from this, that this is just a van der Monde determinant. So you get JA minus JB divided by A minus B. That is what you check, that this is so A greater than B. Okay. And so we see if this now is not 0 modulo P, well, then I defined my epsilon as the minimum ones such that this determinant, a certain determinant, a Wronskian, became non-zero. But if this works already for A is 0, 1, 2, etc., then of course that must be those must be the minimal epsilon. So in that case, we find just that. And then the preceding lemma gives this expression for the order at P of R. Okay, so we do such local calculations, but we can draw an immediate conclusion from this, namely, we know that these numbers j, I, in particular jn, is less than or equal the degree of our linear system, right? The degree of the divisor defining the linear system, because we are talking about the orders of these divisors in the linear system at the point, at a certain point. So you see that if p corollary, if p is greater, if our characteristic p is greater than d, or well, say p is zero, characteristic zero, then d is classical. Then yeah, then delta is classical. Delta is classical, or this L is classical, maybe I should say. L is classical, classical, and I know that we have that the order and the order at a point P of R is, say, some ji minus I. Okay, so you see that the situation becomes very special if the characteristic is small with respect to the degree. This I consider as a large, very large, very large characteristic. So for small characteristics, we have very special things, and that's what we will encounter. But we will go now on and prove one more of these things. Maybe I should make a remark. So if I have say A over M modulo P, so we are looking at such a binomial coefficients modulo P. Well, so when is this, so suppose that M is greater than or equal to zero, and I ask when is A not zero modulo P? Well, this happens if and only if M is p-adically smaller than A. So this happens precisely if M is p-adically smaller than A. I mean, you write A as A0 plus A1 times P plus AR times p to the r, where the ai are between 0 and p minus 1. And you do the same for m, and then you compare a0 and m0, a1 and m1, and so on. And that and you interpret smaller in that sense. So maybe this is a little exercise, of course. You could look at 1 plus x to the a, and then you look at the coefficient of x to the power m to get the binomial coefficient. And of course, you can write this as 1 plus x to the power a0, 1 plus x to the power a1 times p, and so on. But of course, here I can take the p inside. And when you use it, you will have no difficulty in proving this. So now I need one more little technical lemma, which says that if I have an element epsilon that belongs to this set epsilon 0 to epsilon n, and epsilon choose m is not 0 modulo p, right? If we have that, then I claim that m also belongs to this set. That's useful because you can see, you get some information about these numbers epsilon. And so how do we do this? So proof, we may assume that m is positive, and we know that m is less than epsilon, this element epsilon that I have here. And so I let epsilon r, which I order them in increasing order, of course, let epsilon r be the largest element of these epsilon, such that epsilon r is less than m. Okay. And then we look at the matrix. So what we do is we write down the epsilon 0, epsilon 0, this binomial coefficient. And I make a whole matrix, epsilon r, epsilon r. But now I make the matrix a little bit larger. I write here epsilon over epsilon 0. I mean the binomial coefficients, epsilon, epsilon r. And now I add also a row, namely epsilon 0 over m up to epsilon over m. Right? I look at this matrix. It's a big matrix, but it is a triangular matrix. And you see it has ones on the diagonal here, and this one is not 0 modulo p, so its determinant, the determinant is not 0 modulo p. Okay, but if the determinant is not 0 modulo p, if I do again the calculation for these Wronskian, then you see by the minimality of the epsilon, so the minimality of these epsilons implies then, minimality of these epsilon, all the epsilon of the epsilons, epsilon I, implies then, it implies that epsilon r plus 1 is less than or equal to m. Yeah, but then again the minimality implies that r epsilon r plus 1 is equal to m. Right? So that is a similar argument. You always develop, and then you get things like that, but some coefficients in front, and we look whether this coefficient in front vanishes or not. So this is some technical lemma that we need. And now it's time to go back to curves over finite fields. So now back to curves over FQ. Right? FQ is now our finite field, so we have to be a little bit more careful. But so I have my curve now C over FQ. And well, but I can also view it as a curve over the algebraic closure of FQ. But we are interested, of course, in the FQ rational points, so the points of degree 1 over FQ. So we are interested in CFQ. But so we have the Frobenius map on this curve and on all the points of C over FQ bar. Namely, it sends a point with certain coordinates to the point with the coordinates raised to the Q power. So these points, so these are the fixed points of our Frobenius map, Frobenius, that raises coordinates to the qth power. Yes, because the elements that satisfy the equation a to the q is equal to a are exactly the elements that lie in fq. So that is a way of finding these points. Okay, so we now argue a little bit again as last time. So, but now instead of the epsilons, I will use nu's. So we look at elements nu 0 up to nu n minus 1. To the n. So I look now at those tuples and so in order to define them we do as for the epsilon, we look at certain Wronskians namely, so let's look at how we started. So we have f0 and then we had F0, I'm writing a matrix, so Fn. And then we take the Hasse derivative, so we have our parameter, yes, so we have our separating variable t, and I look at dt and nu 0 of f, nu 0 of Fn. And so I continue d nu n minus 1 t f dt nu n minus 1 f. I look at such a matrix and I look in particular at the determinant and I'm asking whether this determinant is non-zero. Well, this was how I defined the epsilon, yes? So if we are talking about how we were doing the epsilon. But now we make a small change, namely we raise the fi here to the qth power. And apart from that, I do not change anything, so we could take nu 0 is equal to 0. And I ask, can I find such nu that the determinant is not equal to 0? So the claim is there exists an n-tuple nu such that let's give this thing a name, the Wronskian of nu with respect to t of the f's. Such that this Wronskian nu f t is not identically zero. And how do we see that? Well, we argue, since we have already the epsilon, right? So we just look at the smallest, so look at the smallest non-negative integer, integer m, such that this first row is linearly dependent, so such that f0q fnq is linearly dependent over the function field, dependent on d epsilon 0 t f up to d m, I should have. Yeah, d epsilon m t f. Right, I look at the first integer such that this thing becomes linearly independent of these. Well, then you see that we will have that the new I, so then our new I, we want to choose the new I in a minimal way. So we start with new zero is zero, and then we continue. But you see then that the new I, if I choose them minimally, that they are equal to epsilon I if I is less than m, and epsilon I plus 1 if I is greater than or equal to m. Right? Because at some point this vector is linearly independent, linear dependent of the other ones, right? So that is so we see not only that it exists, but also what these new I, how this rule that these new I satisfy. Okay, so it's important that we choose these new I minimally. So we choose them minimally. So that is something that we will use time and again. Okay, so you see this situation is very similar to what we had before, except there is something now that really depends on the field over which we are working, and that is the Q over here. Okay, good. But yes, so we can consider then this W nu T of F, this Wronskian, this determinant, and we can again observe that of course it depends on certain choices that I made, namely I made the choice of this basis F0 to Fn of my linear system, defining the map, and we can of course apply a projective transformation. And then you see, if you calculate what happens with this function, then the determinant of this projective transformation comes out in exactly the same way as it did before. And also, you can multiply all f's by a common function, h, and then it will come out at a certain power. I mean, we have seen it came out with a power n plus 1, but here you see it will come out with a power n plus q, because if I multiply here with h, it comes out with h to the power q. And similarly, if I change my separating variable t to another separating variable s, you also see that the same rule that we had before for when we discussed the other case with the epsilons, it comes out. So the conclusion will be that this is an element, defines an element of, like before, but now instead of the epsilon we have the nu, some nu I times k plus, and here I get n plus q times delta. So it's exactly the same argument as last time, that this Wronskian defines an element of this space. If you have seen vector bundle or line bundles, then you would just say this thing defines a section of the corresponding line bundle. But, well, we are talking here about these spaces L of functions, so it defines an element here. Well, that's very good, because for the same reason, I mean, you do it by local calculation, and then you see that this is this thing is effective, yes? So that is what we see. So before we had this divisor R, so here, so this gives an effective divisor S, so S is effective, and S is linearly equivalent to what is written here. Some new I is 0 to n minus 1 times k plus n plus q times delta. You see, it's very nice. We find an effective divisor that on this curve, given the data with which we started. But here comes the important observation. Well, I erased my matrix. That was a bit of it's a pity, because, well, the matrix was like this. And then I had delta, well, zero. But what is delta zero? That is just F0 up to Fn. And then, of course, I get delta nu 1 T F0 and so on. Delta nu 1 T Fn. That was the matrix that we were looking at. And what do you now observe? Well, if I have a point, which is a rational point, well, for a rational point, these values are the same, right? Because for a rational point, then a coordinate A, well, A to the Q is equal to A. So these two lines will become, at this point P, will become dependent. So the determinant will vanish. So if P is a rational point, then we have that S is greater than or equal to P. In other words, P is contained in the support of this divisor S. All the rational points are contained in this divisor S. Okay, but that's very nice, because we want to make an estimate how many rational points there are. And we find now a divisor that contains all the FQ rational points. But you see, it depends really on Q now. If I change my Q, the situation changes completely. S might change, right? But we have this divisor, and we know the degree of this divisor. That is clear, because we know, well, if we know the news, of course, but we know the degree of K, and we know the degree of delta, so we know, in principle, the degree of this divisor. So that's very good, because now if we can sort of bound this, we have a bound on the number of points. And that's what we are going to do. Okay. Well, you might ask, is this the only thing that can give points in S? No, certainly not. But, namely, so if another way, if we have a point P with if P is a point with J0 Jn is equal to so nu n minus one, nu zero to nu n minus one. So if we have a point like this, and we have that the Frobenius map associated to, well, I mean the Frobenius map applied to this point P lies in the osculating hyperplane, then we have also that this phi p, then p, sorry, p lies in the support of S. So there can be other points, I mean, but we can sort of forget about it. There might be other points, but in any case, we have all the rational points in S. That is for us the most important observation. Okay. But what we now will do is we will estimate the order at a rational point of S. Or better, we would like to estimate it, so something like this. Better. Right? At the rational points. That is what we would like to do. And you see, because if the order at a rational point is large, then we can divide this degree by this large number, if this is true for all points, and then we get a good bound on the number of rational points. And that is what we do. So, first proposition now. So, proposition one, say, let P be a rational point, so P is in C FQ, FQ rational point, then the order at P, the order at P of S is greater than or equal to the sum ji minus nu I minus 1, where I runs from 1 to n. Right. So of course we have this point P, we also have the numbers ji, and we have these numbers nu I now, but we see that we have this bound, and also we can say antiequality if and only if the determinant of the J A nu B, if the determinant of this matrix, where A now runs between 1 and n minus 1, and B runs between 0 and n minus 1, if this determinant is not 0 modulo P. Okay, let's do the calculation. And here you see it's important to assume that the point is a rational point, because P is a rational point. But this means, FQ rational point, this means that the spaces that I defined yesterday, L0, well, L0 is the point, L1 is the tangent line, L2, etc. These spaces, these osculating planes at the point, they are all defined over FQ, right? Because they are defined by a geometric property, and this property, I mean, is defined over FQ. So these are defined over FQ. Because yesterday, in order to do all these calculations with these Husserl derivatives, I assume that things are locally given by t to the power jb, let's say. But in order to do that, I maybe have to apply a projective transformation. But this projective transformation now must be defined over FQ. But it is, because all these spaces are defined over FQ. So we may assume that this F FB is, say, given by t to the power jb plus higher order terms. Okay, and we also may assume that f0 is equal to 1, because we do a local calculation at the point P, so we can just divide all these functions by f0, and then f0 becomes 1. So we may assume that f0 is 1. And then you see that the determinant simplifies, and we have that this Wronskian of nu with respect to t of our f, that this is the same as the determinant. And now you see, well, I have, of course, f0 is 1. So you see, you can simplify the determinant, and what remains is f1 minus f1 to the power q, and here I get fn minus fn to the power q, and for the rest I just have these d nu 1 d nu 1 t f1 etc. d nu 1 t fn, and so I make a square matrix, right? That is the determinant. Okay, so well, and then I apply these Hasse derivatives, and then you see that the exponents go down from ji with nu I minus 1, etc. So, I mean, the calculation is just as the calculations that we did before, and you get again binomial coefficients, and so we get an equality. I mean, the highest term that we are calculating, that is really the highest term if this determinant is non-vanishing. So I leave it at that calculation maybe. So that is the first estimate that we have. And now there is a simple observation, namely proposition 2. Suppose that I have a rational point again. Suppose I have a rational point, and I have again this JLP, and the situation is J0 up to JN, see? And suppose I have now integers, I have, suppose we have MI integers with 0 is less than or equal m0, less than m1, less than up to mn minus 1. Suppose that we have such integers such that a certain determinant of binomial coefficients, ja minus j1 over mb, where A runs between 1 and n minus 1, and B runs from 0 to, n, n minus 1. So suppose that we have that this is not 0 modulo p, then the claim is that because of the minimality that we have that the new I are less than or equal the mi. And the argument for this is the same. I start calculating and then you see that if this determinant is non-zero, well, then this this is either the minimal one or another one. But so from this you see that the new I must be less than or equal to the mi, just by the minimality. So, I mean, you start calculating the Wronskian, and the minimality implies it, so by the minimality. And you see that the Wronskian is not zero by just looking at this first term, and that the coefficient of that is not zero modulo p. Okay. Well, we soon can now make a good estimate on the orders at rational points of our divisor S. So the proposition 2, proposition 3, I should say. Proposition 3 now says so for P in CFQ, a rational point again. For such a rational point, we have that the new I, the new I do not depend on the rational point, but for a rational point we have the ji, and the claim is that this is less than ji plus 1 minus j1. Okay, so the proof. Well, we again calculate a determinant, but the matrix, if I look at JA minus J1, JB minus J1, where we run over A and B, A and B. So this matrix has a determinant which is not zero modulo P, because it is a triangular matrix, this matrix, and these elements on the diagonal are not zero. So if I apply this proposition 2, I find that so is not zero, zero modulo P, because triangular, hence by proposition 2 I find that these the new I are less than these numbers. So the new I are less than the ji minus j1, ji plus 1 minus j1. That is what we find. Right? Okay, well, that's very good, because now we get a corollary, and the corollary gives us immediately an estimate for the multiplicity of a rational point in S. So the corollary it says so for P, a rational point, C in CFQ, we have that the order of S at P is greater than or equal to N times J1. So if we have a non-singular point, J1 is 1, then the multiplicity of such a rational point is at least N. So you see, it comes with a high multiplicity, such a point occurring, a rational point, it comes with a high multiplicity in the divisor S. So prove. So we just know that the order, we observed this before, the order at P of S, well, it is greater than or equal to J I minus nu I minus 1. I is 1 to n minus 1. N. So this is what we observed before. And now you see that we know that the new I is less than or equal to j I plus 1 minus j 1, what we observed here. So that means that j I minus nu I minus 1 contributes at least a j 1. So we get that this is, so we get at least n times j1, right? So that is very good, because now you see we have a very nice estimate. So let me recover a few more corollaries now. So corollary, is that if the nu n minus 1 is not equal to 0, 1 up to n minus 1, or something special happens, then each rational point is an L osculation point, is an L osculation point. And the second statement, so it's a wire sus point for L. And so if nu 0 up to nu n minus 1 is not equal to epsilon 0 up to epsilon n minus 1, then each rational point is an L-Weierstrass point. Why? Well, so if we have that proof, if we have that the point is not an osculation point, so that if the JLP is just 0 up to n, well, then we have then we have, by our estimates, we have nu I is I. For I is 0 to n minus 1, so that immediately contradicts this, this first statement. And the second statement, again, if it is not a Weierstrass point, so if we have that that the j's, if the ji are equal to the epsilon I, so that is if it is not a Weierstrass point, then we see that we know a priori from the construction how we made these, how we found those nu I, that nu I is either epsilon I or epsilon I plus 1. That is what we saw when we constructed them. Okay, but on the other hand, we know that the nu I is less than or equal to j I plus 1 minus j 1. So that means that nu I is less than or equal to epsilon I, but then of course nu I is equal to epsilon I. Right? Okay, so that is the situation, and now we can harvest. So here we have the theorem of Stöhr and Voloch, which they proved in 1985. And what theorem? Stöhr and Voloch. So in the situation in which we are, so let's say, see, we have a curve, smooth projective curve over FQ. I have a base point free linear system, as it is called, of degree D. Okay, then of course I have then we have the nu 0 up to nu n minus 1. I mean, that is how we define them in a minimal way. So we have also the nus. And then the statement is the number of rational points on C over FQ is less than or equal to, well, the sum of the nu I times 2g minus 2 plus q plus n. N is the, yeah, of dimension, I should have said, if dimension n, q plus n times d, and then the whole thing divided, divided by n. And the proof, well, we have already proven it, because we know that each rational point is contained in S, in our divisor S, which we constructed, which is an effective divisor, and each point is contained with multiplicity at least n, as we saw, right? So I can divide by n. So we get here a wonderful bound on the number of points on C over FQ. So that's the end of the proof. Okay. So now, of course, we must prove Hasse-Weil. And as we have seen in one of the earlier lectures, in order to prove Hasse-Weil, I must prove an upper bound But it doesn't matter over which field I prove it, right? If the I can replace Q by high powers of Q. So we can assume that we have a high power of a very high, very big Q. So let me first write it, corollary, which is the, as we have seen, it implies the Hasse-Weil bound. Namely, it says that the number of points on C over FQ minus Q minus 1, that this, yeah, well, in absolute value, we have seen the upper bounds will imply also this, because this, well, we had needed a little argument to see also a lower bound, but we did this, so this is less than 2g square root of Q. That is the statement. This is what we want to prove. We want to prove, in fact, so we see it suffices to prove the upper bound. Okay, so let's do the proof. Okay, so the first observation is we may assume that the curve has a rational point, because if it has no rational points, obviously I have an upper bound. So may assume there is a rational point. May assume we have a rational point. Okay. And then I take a complete linear series, so let L, I mean, say this delta, be a complete linear series. That is what I mean by complete linear series. It's really the projective space corresponding to L of D, the L of delta. Let be a complete linear series. Series of degree. Well, I take, call the degree D, and I take it greater than or equal 2 times the genus. G is the genus. And okay, well, the thing is that this exists because we can take this delta is d times p, with p a point, a rational point, right? Of course, the linear system, etc., must be defined over fq. Okay, so, and then, well, then, yeah, so then by Riemann-Roch, you see, that was one of the exercises I gave in the very beginning. Then you see that n is equal to d minus g. Okay, by Riemann-Roch, because the d is greater than 2g. And you check that L is base point free. L is base point free, which I could give as an exercise. Again, using Riemann-Roch, you can do this. And I also notice that n is greater than or equal to the genus. That is by the assumption that d is at least 2g. Okay, then the first observation is that for I less than n minus g, for indices I less than n minus g, we have that the new I is equal to I. I mean, of course, what we now must do, we must calculate the new I, or estimate the new I. But so we have this, that in this case, this is new I. Yeah, because that was also the same exercise when I gave it, because in that case, because then, I mean under these conditions that I have, we have the ji is equal to I. I gave an exercise, I think the second lecture, and then I said prove n is d minus g, but also prove that ji is equal to I. So that is that. And hence we see that epsilon I is equal to I, because epsilon is less than or equal to ji, so epsilon is also equal to, and we have that nu I is less than ji plus 1 minus j1. So you see that we have this, that we have nu I is equal to I. But you see, yeah, you see that nu I is less than that, but we also know that nu I is equal to epsilon I or epsilon I plus 1, but it, if it is really less than epsilon I plus 1, it must be equal to epsilon I, and that is I, so we have nu I is equal to I. Okay, that is the first thing that we do. And then, or maybe it's better not to erase this. Then we go to the case that I is greater than greater than or equal to n minus g. Then we do we have to be a little bit more rough, but anyway, for I is equal to n minus g up to n minus 1, we have the following. Well, we have, first of all, we know that jn is less than or equal to the degree of the linear system, yes, because we were looking at the orders of the divisors in the linear system at this point, so that must certainly be less than or equal to the degree of the total divisor delta. Okay, so we have, but we know that the j's, if I go a step down, jn minus 1 must be at least one smaller than this. So I find that the ji is less than d or equal to d minus n minus I hope. Yes, because the j's are different. The j's are increasing with increasing indices. So I see that the nu I is less than or equal to ji plus 1 minus j1, as we proved. So this is less than or equal to d plus I minus n, and this is because of what we had there, n is d minus g. You see this is the same as g plus I. Okay, so that is an estimate on our nu I. And now I apply this Stör-Vorloch theorem, and so what do we get? We get that the number n, so that's the number of points, n is the number of points of C over FQ, that this is equal to the sum where I runs from 1 to n minus g minus 1, and then the multiplicity was just I, nu I is I, and in the other case I get, so the sum from I is equal to n minus g to n minus 1, it is this g plus I. Okay, and this I multiply with 2g minus 2. Okay, and then I get still the q plus n plus q plus n times d. But then I have to divide everything by n. So let me put the n here and an n here. Okay, so we applied the Stör-Voloh theorem. So I can now erase it. So we have to estimate this a bit. So what is this? This is equal, well, I mean, let me just give the final result. I mean, everybody can sum this. And so this is equal to 2 g squared times g minus 1 over n plus n plus q over n times the g plus q plus 1. So that is an estimate. I mean, I said here, this is of course an estimate, right? We have estimated these things, yes? So we have estimated, so we get this estimate for this number n. So we get that n is less than or equal to this. This is what we arrive. Yeah, and now we take n is equal to square root of q. Of course, we take q as square, we can do that. So we replace q by a power that we want. N is square root of q, so q is square. And I mean, I take q much, much larger than g, so that this contribution, this first contribution, plays no role anymore. And then you see that we take q larger than 4g to the power 4 times g minus 1 squared. And n larger than g. And then you see that we get the required bound. I mean, we see that we get q plus 1 plus 2g times square root of q. This gives square root of q, this gives square root of q. And so 2g square root of q plus something which is negligible for us. So this gives us the required bound. So this gives the required bound. Sorry? The what?
The D.
Yes, the D. That is right. So what happened with the D? That is true. I sort of omitted one step, and in the step you would you would use this, and you would see that you can express d as n plus g. So that is how use, maybe I should say this, use d is n plus g and substitute it, and then you get right. But the d disappeared, but that is the reason. That is by these assumptions that we did. If the d is greater than or equal to 2g, then the dimension n is just d minus g, right? So d is then n plus g. Okay, so, well, as I said earlier, there are various proofs. The first proof for the Hasse-Wey bound, well, by Hasse it was given for the case genus 1, and by Wey it was given in the general case, but he uses the theory of the Jacobian, of abelian varieties. Well, that would lead us further afield here, so that seems an approach that we cannot do here. Then I said at the end of the 60s, Stepanov gave a proof that only uses Riemann-Roch. I could have given the proof here, but if I read this proof, well, I mean, you see, it works, but I sort of get no ideas from that proof. And then later, Stern-Voloch came with this proof. And I find this is, in some sense, a very nice proof. Of course, it will not generalize to other cases, to higher dimension or whatever, but it is something very geometric. If you have a curve, and if you have a linear system, I mean, usually you look at the curve in projective space, etc., then if it is defined over FQ, you find an effective divisor S which contains all the rational points. And with a certain multiplicity that we can estimate. And so you see this. And what you also see from this proof and this whole approach, if a curve has really very many points over FQ, then something special will happen with these curves. These points will have in the curve viewed in some projective space, you see that these points will have special properties. Yes, so they will be flex points or points with high osculation properties. So that is sort of the philosophy behind this, and this indeed can be used to say something about curves with very many points. Maybe next time I will mention a little bit about that. So in the remaining two lectures that I still have, there are two things that I want to do. First, I want to, so we have this Hasse-Wey bound, but we will see there are improvements of this bound. So there are improvements, and I will talk a bit about these improvements. That is what I will do tomorrow. And then on Wednesday, in the last lecture, I will talk about how do you construct curves with many rational points. So, and that is a sport in itself, to try to construct curves with many rational points. Such curves with many rational points play an important role, for example, in coding theory. I mean, it was maybe referred to yesterday in Zwassmann's talk. But also for other things, they can be important, and this is the thing that I will do in the last lecture. Okay, thank you.